And thanks, Leo, for all your fantastic work on making these schools a success. I think some of the lecturers at this school, like Lisa, were at earlier schools, and they were important in their career, meeting people and making contacts. So can you hear me? Okay, all right. So today I would like to talk about, try to convince you that in really soft systems, I'll actually be talking mostly about thin shell liquid crystals. So they're fluids, they flow, you can pour them out. You've seen liquid crystals, and you find them in laptop displays and watches and all over the place, but they're liquids, they pour. I want to convince you that you can make structures from these things that are more reminiscent of like gemstones, of very hard objects. Okay? And this will arise because of a frustration, competition between ordering and shape change. So this is fundamentally, there's going to be an equilibrium problem, and it involves the origin of shape, okay, and how it depends on just competition between parameters in a system, between two basic terms in a Hamiltonian. So this is based on two papers, this one here, PNS 2012 with Sean Jing and company, and this one with my postdoc, Oksana Manyahina, PRL this year, recent paper. So they're going to be two basic ingredients. We will have a system with a Hamiltonian that has two pieces. So there's going to be some kind of order field. We'll describe which kinds in a minute. And then there's going to be a piece which has to do with shape. Now, there's going to be two-dimensional systems, but these two-dimensional surfaces are embedded in some three-dimensional space. And so the wrinkle in this problem is that this Hamiltonian here is going to be an integral over some surface that you have yet to determine. Okay? The whole surface, which is an infinite dimensional system, described by some continuous metric and so on, is going to be a solution of a minimization problem. So even to write the Hamiltonian, you have to have solved the problem. Okay? The second piece will involve changes in shape of the surface. And that involves how the surface is embedded in three dimensions. And for that, you need to know what the surface is as well. So it looks like you're sunk before you even start. Okay? But I would like to show you how, in some limits, you can basically write down the answer. And the answer is kind of surprising. Now, we will, you'll see why, but we will move to not to planar systems where the problem is trivial, because you can have something very uniform and something very flat, but we'll be working on systems without any boundaries. So we'll be working on the two-dimensional sphere. And once you do that, you'll see that there have to be some topological defects in the problem. And these topological defects will play a crucial role in the solution. They provide naturally marked points where you can concentrate different kinds of singularities, two different kinds. So along the way, I'll introduce some things about topological defects, which will also be useful for lectures coming tomorrow and next week on active pneumatics. Okay, so let's look first of all at these two pieces. Now this one here is one you've already seen in Efrati's lectures. So this is going to be a bending energy term, this shape. So this will be given by some bending rigidity kappa. So that's going to have dimensions of energy, and it's going to be one of the main parameters I have to deal with in the system. And then it's an integral over a surface. That's the surface that we've yet to determine. And so there's going to be, you know, some metric in this problem, square root of g d squared x. And then it's the mean curvature of the system squared. allowing for some possible spontaneous preferred value of the mean curvature H0. So this Hamiltonian, you've seen it before, but it goes by various names. It's a very, very important functional. It's a functional of this surface here in mathematics as well. This is called the Wilmore functional. And it basically measures how far something departs from being a round two-sphere. So the mathematicians put various bounds, and there are various exact results on this Hamiltonian as a function of the topology of the manifold sigma and so on. In the theory of membranes, this is called the Helfrich canon energy. What is this H here? You've already seen it, but H appearing inside this Hamiltonian, so this energy density, is a trace, one half the trace of the second fundamental form of the surface, so that's called K alpha beta. It's a vector, so this H should be a vector here. K alpha beta is covariant derivative d alpha of a tangent vector on the surface. So it tells you how tangent vectors change as you move along the surface. This trace is taken with a spectrometric, so this will be one half g alpha beta K alpha beta. And in three dimensions, this H you can show because the covariant derivative here of the tangent vector is along the normal, since it doesn't, when you dot it into the tangent vector, this vanishes because tangent vector is constant. So this H is actually along this H alpha beta, well, this is a trace. This is along the normal to the surface n, so I can just take H as the component along the normal n. Yes. K alpha beta is this covariant, oops, sorry, this should be x. T is a tangent vector. Covariant derivative of the tangent vector T beta.
So D alpha, capital D alpha is a covariant derivative.
Yes, this is covariant derivative. Here I don't need a covariant derivative because this is a scalar. But now this is a vector, so when I take derivatives here I need a covariant derivative.
Wait, so tangent vector on a surface?
So tangent vector T, yeah. So you have a surface with coordinates alpha x, z alpha and x beta, and t beta is just d beta of x. X is the, so you have coordinates here, x alpha, z1, x2, and x is the mapping of this surface into, say, three-dimensional space. Oh, okay, well, I'm not going to write that out, but this D will be an ordinary derivative plus a connection piece. Okay. And one of the tricks, we will not have to deal explicitly with this and what I'm going to discuss. We'll finesse that problem. But yeah. Are there more questions? Yes.
So H is a trace of the K alpha beta.
Yes.
So why is it a vector?
Because K is a vector. Because this is a regular vector. The tangent vector is a vector in space. So if I tried to leave off this, the K alpha beta picks up this vector here.
Okay.
So it's a tensor in the two-dimensional sense, and a vector in the three-dimensional sense. it's inherited from this vector here. X, this a point here, is also a three-dimensional vector, X in space.
So each element of the tensor is a vector.
Yes, exactly.
So why not just have a rank three tensor?
No, because this is a different space. This refers to a vector in R3, and this is on the two-dimensional. Yeah. That's why, so this is called, this second fundamental form, it measures this extrinsic property of not just intrinsic things to the surface, but how the surface is embedded in R3. And we want to play with that embedding to minimize this Hamiltonian that's going to have two pieces in it. That's going to be the whole problem. Yeah. So here, this was the case that Effie called, you know, it's a two-dimensional surface living in three-dimensional space. So both properties of the two-dimensional surface itself and how it looks changing its shape in three dimensions are relevant. And you see it there with that extrinsic curvature matrix. So you have to keep simultaneously these two different mathematical characteristics of the thing in mind, the surface and how it looks in 3D. Good. More questions? The basic setup will be crucial because everything will follow from that. Yeah. That's the area element. This one here? Yeah. That is just dA on the surface. Great. Lots of good questions. Now, if we just had that, we would just have a fluid membrane, right? It can flow to adjust to any change in shape. But we want to add a bit more structure to this system. And this is what I call a vesicle. So we want to add another field that lives on this two-dimensional surface. And there are various kinds we could consider. Okay, we could consider some kind of a magnetic field, or a vector field of some kind. And I'm going to vary the order of the field later in the lecture to see how you can get different kinds of ground state shapes. But the one I want to focus on today is the case of liquid crystalline order on this 2D surface. A, because there are nice experimental realizations that led to thinking about this problem, and B, because you saw in Efrati's lectures all of the physics of these two-dimensional liquid crystals. So what will we have here? I'm going to have system the following kind. So it's going to be, again, an integral over a surface to be determined. And I'm going to have, in general, two-dimensional liquid crystal. Remember, what are the allowed configurations for allowed kind of deformations for 2D liquid crystal? Bend and splay, right. We'll just have bend and splay. So the splay is usually goes with an elastic constant K1. So this will be, again, I'll need covariant derivatives. So I'll need covariant divergence of a field, let's call it N. N is a line field. It only has an orientation. It doesn't have a direction. Okay. So I'll just write it like N, or if you want to draw arrows on it, you should put arrows both ways. But anyway, it's covariant divergence of N squared, K1, plus the bend term, which is a covariant curl of this N field, integrated over the surface. Yes, that's fine. Yep. Yes. No, okay, so this is a fundamental point. Okay. So for a liquid crystal, what we have at any point in space is simply an orientation. Okay? So this means that we only have some direction, which is the statistically average of the orientation of a set of local, sort of, say, anisotropic molecules in the system. But at this point, it's an orientation. It's not a direction, so it doesn't have any vector characteristic. So it's just a line. So in two dimensions, this space is the set of lines through the origin, or rays, like this. So that's what I mean by N. So if I fix the magnitude of N, if I take N to be a unit vector, then this makes this a priori has two components, NX and NY, but the sum of the squares is one. So that means I have a point on a circle, but I have antipodal points identified. So the space on which N lives is the circle with antipodal points identified. So that's S1 mod Z2. So this is a projective space. This is called RP1.
Okay. So this is like, I could like invert N here and it would be the same. I could call N a vector.
If I call N a vector, I have to identify it with minus N. So there's really no need to do that.
It's probably not very important at this stage.
No. It'll be important at the stage of defects, although in 2D even not that much. Did that answer the question? Yeah. Yes. It's the same as up here. Right. We can call it DA. But yeah, exactly the same. So this one, configurations like this. Okay. Display that you were talking about, like this. And this one of bend configurations. Like this. Yep. No, you still can't have a twist because in 2D, so in general you have divergence of N squared. You have N dot curl of N squared, and you have N cross curl of N squared. In 2D, N cross curl of N is the same as curl of N, and this one vanishes. Because the curl of N lives in the third dimension. The Z component is no in the product with N. So even if the surface twisted, the liquid crystal is actually living inside this surface. So you can view that as an intrinsic 2D liquid crystal just on a curved surface. It's in this shape, sigma, that the shape of sigma, that the embedding occurs. Yeah, that's one of the nice features here. Okay, so I'm going to treat actually two cases at once in this Hamiltonian here. I'm going to treat either K1 equals K3. This is standard, so this is called the one Frank constant approximation. So this is equal bend and splay. So that means I have, and I'll call this K. Okay. So this means this, and K is an energy in 2D. So this means this H order will be K. There's a 1/2 in here also. this k will be, this h will be k over 2, and then divergence of n squared plus curl of n squared. This here, and this is an integral. This is just covariant gradient of n squared. So this is called a nonlinear sigma model. And the field theorists love it, but it's really a liquid crystal, 2D liquid crystal. You see that? So if you just write this out, it's good exercise for you. You should do it. Write these two terms out and you'll sum up to this. This is different from that. This is all components squared. So that's one case. So this is a one Frank constant pneumatic. But I'm also going to treat another case. Let's put this up here. Yes. Okay, that one should be first. Let's bring this one down. I didn't write much on this. I'm also going to consider the following case. So I said n had one component, right? A priori has two components, but it's a unit object, so that eliminates one component, so that leaves one. Now let's imagine that we take one of these constants to infinity. Let's take k3 to infinity. So what happens if you do that? What's left? Right, what? Yeah, just pure splay, right? Okay. So let's take k3 to infinity. Means that any bend costs you infinite amount of energy. So this leaves you pure splay. Now what is that? If I have pure splay configurations, write them like this, I can draw the orthogonal level set to this system. And it looks like this. This is a set of equally spaced layers. Yeah. Yes. And that's what I'm going to explain here. So this system with a set of equally spaced layers is called a symmetric, 2D symmetric, where the symmetric layers are orthogonal to n. So if I make the interpretation that the orthogonal vector to n is to be interpreted as the symmetric layers, then I'm describing a 2D symmetric. So in this case, I'm left just with K1, right? And I'll call K1 is identified with K. And then my Hamiltonian is just K over 2 integral of this divergence of N squared, the pure splay. How many components are left now? How many degrees of freedom do I have here?
No, you have the layers.
I'm absolutely freezing the layer spacing for this. Right, 0, right? So I had one degree of freedom, but this K3 going to infinity or pure splay is the same as saying that the curl of n is 0. So that's another equation. So that eliminates my last component. So this n is completely determined. Pure splay is completely determined. 2D. Absolutely crucial this is in 2D. Remember, this is So this is epsilon alpha beta, DL for n beta. So this is a scalar here. So I can set it to zero. In fact, let me show you what this kind of structure is. If I have this, this means that D1, I'll call the components on the surface alpha and beta 1 and 2. This means D1 N2 equals D2 N1, right? And D1 N1 is obviously D1 N1. So I can write that D alpha N beta is D beta N alpha. So let me compute the following thing. Let me compute the covariant derivative of n along n. This tells you whether the thing changes along itself as you move the vector along itself. So this will look like n1, this is n1 d1 plus n2 d2 acting on n. So let me take component 1 here, say. And I can do it for component 2 as well. So now I have n1, d1, n1. And here I have n2, d2, n1. What's that? Yes, thank you. Exactly, good. Here I can replace this by d1 n2 because its curl vanishes. That's the pure Blais constraint. So now I have n1 d1 n1 plus N2, D1, N2. And what is this? This is 1/2 D1 of N squared, right? N1 squared plus N2 squared. And this is a constant. This is 1. So this is 0. You see that? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you. Right, you can write it as epsilon alpha beta d alpha n beta. You know, yeah, but I don't have curl in here. I only have this. Well, yeah. Solving the equation. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I'm solving here. So this means that n is, this is called an integral integral vector field, right? Integral curve, or geodesic. It's exactly the same as a geodesic. It vanishes along itself. So it's completely determined. For example, you have configurations like on the sphere. You can have configurations like this, pure splay. Once you have it everywhere. Just move it along itself because it's covariantly constant. Okay, so that's the symmetric case.
Sorry, what does it equal zero?
Oh, yeah. That's this constraint here. So pure splay means no bend. No bend means the curl of n is zero.
Right.
So that's what I'm solving here. I'm telling you that implies that n is covariantly constant along itself. So if you move along itself, it can't change. So you just move it like a geodesic. You have the curve at any point, and you flow along the curve. That gives it everywhere over the surface. And that's why it's determined. There's no freedom. You can't start doing this. It has to move always. It has to develop along itself. Okay, so we'll be treating both those cases at once with a different interpretation of K. Okay, so let's go over here. Yeah, they're constraints, actually. Right. Yes. So one was just what we mean by n, and the second was this pure splay case. So the second thing followed just for the symmetric. And now we're going to study the sum of these two terms. Okay? So we have k over 2. Integral over the surface sigma write it like this, or with just one term for the symmetric case, plus the shape. Now, of course, so I could just have, so this tells you two things here. This term here tells you that n wants to be uniform, if you want the ground state, and also that you don't like any curvature on the surface, because there are two ways you can have contribution from this term. You can have an inhomogeneous, you can have n varying along the surface, that'll give you gradients, and you can have curvature, intrinsic curvature on the surface, which will contribute to this through the connection. So minimizing the energies of these kinds of systems tells you basically you want to be uniform, everything lined up, and you want to be sort of flat. So there's, of course, a trivial solution. You can just have a lamellar-like structure. Right? You can just have a system like this. In the symmetric case, it would just be uniform like this everywhere.
Okay. Can I ask, one thing that's not here is that you can also couple to the extrinsic
curvature. That's here.
Bending energy of the substrate.
Yes.
Now,
yep.
What I'm saying is that if you look at the pneumatic director on top of it, which is the first term, that pneumatic director doesn't only want to be parallel to itself, it also wants to preferentially align with the given director. For example, if I take that from there and draw, and I put it on a cylinder. On a cylinder, any alignment that those layers make, if I
wrap
it up.
That's a technical variant derivative.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
It is if you pick a.
No, it's not, sorry. Because the covariant derivative only tells you make all the all the vectors parallel to themselves. Now, so it means it's making the pneumatic thing stay on geodesics. But out of all those choices, you can single out one simply because it costs more energy. For example, if I put a rod on it, on a cylinder, a single rod, which is like one of your layers, if I put it like this, it costs energy. If I put it like this, it doesn't cost energy. That's not captured by divergence of n squared.
No, but.
In other words, there's the geodesic curvature and the extrinsic curvature.
Yeah, but the layer spacing here is completely fixed.
But then don't make them layered. Make it.
No, spins. That.
If the spins, let's say, are on a cylinder, if the spins are like this along the axis of the cylinder of the line, I call it the zero.
Yes.
If I make them like this around the circle of the cylinder, they they also all align in relation.
Yes.
Like the
same
curve
in embedded space.
Right.
The curve in embedded space.
Exactly.
Yes. Okay. I could have different values of this kappa. I've taken this all uniform. So you're right that the bending rigidity in general is going to have three different components. So I've taken it uniform here to simplify this problem.
Well, okay, but that, again, not what I'm asking. So I'm asking about the coupling of the pneumatic direction to the extrinsic curvature. But if I understand what you're saying, that coupling can be incorporated in an anisotropic coefficient, in an anisotropic bending rigidity.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, but here I'm taking also I'm requiring here the full symmetries of pure 2D pneumatic.
Right, which your microscopic model may not have.
Yes, that's thing? Yes, that's possible. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yes, that's right. Yeah. Okay, so yes.
So you mentioned that you can have an isotropic bending.
Yes.
But you can also have a coupling between, so you can have a commutative end.
Yeah. Yes. So I'm not. I don't have that either. Right. Okay, so. This case, though, you have these lamellar structures like this. This is going to have a boundary, gamma here. So that means that there's going to be some line tension in the problem. Okay. So that it was shown long. So the energy for this term here, this bending energy term, is scale invariant, whereas the energy associated with the line tension having a boundary like this grows as the perimeter of the surface. So Helfrich himself actually showed in the 70s that if the system is sufficiently big, then it will like to remove any holes. So it will spontaneously close up into a two-sphere because there's just too much energy in the line tension here. So I'm going to consider, because of that, closed manifolds. And I'm going to put two of them together and say a bilayer, so there's no preferred spontaneous curvature. So I'm going to simplify this, remove this, and I just have this. So now the only thing we know about this surface is that it has the topology of the two-sphere. It doesn't have any boundary. But we still don't know its shape. Okay? So now there are two limits that are important here. K is an energy, kappa is an energy. So we can have what I call the rigid limit. The rigid limit will be kappa over K, much, much greater than 1. So in that case, changes in shape are going to be very costly. So that means the system is going to be basically round like this. You can think of it as a thin shell. And in that thin shell, we have 2D pneumatic or symmetric. That's one case. The second case, that they call the floppy limit. So this is rigid or floppy with respect to the bending rigidity kappa. So that's going to be the opposite limit. Kappa over K is much less than 1. Now, if you think of this, the lectures you had on membranes and all of that from Efrati and others, this bending rigidity, it's emphasized a lot, goes as thickness cubed, and K goes like thickness. So if you take a very thin shell object, it's quite easy to arrange to be in this floppy limit. So now, the two cases we have are this 2D pneumatic or cement deck. So we have to study the physics of this liquid crystal, but on now on the two-sphere rather than in the plane. That brings some new ingredients. And in this case, let's look first at this case here. What time is it? Let's look at, so case one, the rigid limit, is a, you can call it a spherical pneumatic, or smack deck. I'll tell you how to make these later. From, you can make them from block or polymers or from microfluidic techniques and so on. This actually has quite a bit of interesting physics in it, but more surprising is this floppy limit. So we can even take the extreme limit of this case, where we take the bending rigidity to zero. So this means that you want to minimize this Hamiltonian. So as we said, it wants to be flat and it wants to be uniform. But we have a problem here. We have a topological constraint. It wants to be flat and uniform. So it wants to expel all the Gaussian curvature and be uniform to look as much like the plane as possible. But the integrated Gaussian curvature, okay, over the surface is equal to, so 1 over 2 pi of this is equal to the Euler character of the surface. This is the Gauss-Bonnet theorem, which is 2. So the integrated Gaussian curvature is in fact quite big. It's 4 pi. Okay.
Sorry, so is that k and this k same?
No, this is k of x. So this is Gaussian curvature. So this is the first fundamental form. Yes. Thanks.
That's a determinant of the estimate, right?
Yeah. So if I write it in terms of, if I write it in terms of principal radii of curvature, then at any point R1, some point 2, and R2, principal radii of curvature at any point, H will be the trace. Like I said before, so it's 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2. These are curvatures. And K would be the determinant of this, so 1 over R1, R2. So on the round two-sphere, this would be 1 over R squared. Integrate 1 over R squared over the sphere, you get 4 pi. From the area 4 pi r squared. So here is our, here is the basic frustration in the system. It wants to expel all the Gaussian curvature. Those suggest surfaces that you can get by expelling all Gaussian curvature. Those are called developable surfaces. So these are the things you get if you take a piece of paper And you just bend it without stretching. It doesn't change the Gaussian curvature. So you can roll this up into a cylinder, like Vincenzo was talking about, or a cone, and so on. So you want to have something like that, but you can't because of this constraint. So what's the solution? What's that?
Defects.
Well, yes, defects will play a role. So defects could be placed where you mean curvature defects, right? Where you,
topological defects kind of screen the curvature.
Yeah, so defects will come in, but before that, how can you do this? How can you have it flat and uniform?
You can focus the bending to its flat region.
Yes. That would be concentrating this Gaussian curvature in some points. Yeah. But what about the shape then? So you're sort of, you're almost there. Yeah, so you sort of want to make it as flat as possible everywhere, okay? But topologically be the two-sphere, okay? So there's a very simple solution for that. So let's take the case of the symmetric, right? I said I just have uniform layer spacing, right? So I just take something like this, okay? I draw a uniform order in the plane, and then I just fold it up like this. So in other words, it's has flat faces. Okay. So this is, and remember the bending rigidity here is zero. So in fact, there's no bending rigidity across even edges here if I take bending rigidity to zero. And you notice that as I go across edges, the director field's continuous. So this object has zero liquid crystalline energy, apart from some funny points here, which is related to what you were saying, the defects. So this is clearly a possible solution. Now, in order to fill it in, what I'm arguing is that a faceted structure is the solution in this floppy limit. Exactly where it's very floppy, in order to expel Gaussian curvature, it wants to become flat, exactly the opposite of what your intuition would expect. And that's because there's a premium on minimizing the liquid crystalline energy. And the liquid crystalline energy is exactly zero if you have flat faces. This is flat space everywhere. And then you can link them up nicely to make a faceted structure. Now, I haven't said what kind of faceted structure yet. I showed you one, but we have to argue which one you actually get. Okay? And that will require some knowledge about the defects. Yes? Okay, yeah. So, should we go straight through or should we? Okay, let's keep going. So actually, what kind of surfaces can we get here? So for that, we need to go back and think about various kinds of order on something that's topologically round, okay? So let's have a little primer on topological defects because this is useful and relevant. But let me first go back to a vector field. So let's take a vector field on the two-sphere. So can we have a vector field that's everywhere and non-vanishing on the two-sphere? Okay, no, right? This is called the hairy ball theorem, or Poincaré-Hopf theorem. How many places does it need to vanish? So you can think of wind velocity, for example, on the surface of the Earth. Okay, two places. Any other offers? Yeah, you can have one. So let's look at what the theorem actually is. So the theorem is that the theorem is that if you have a vector field that has a defect, and I'll explain what the defects are in a minute, it has an index or a strength, okay? And the theorem is that the sum over all the zeros of the vector field, and you compute the index at zero I, so I is a member of a zeros, this has to equal chi, which is a topological invariant of the manifold, which is in this case 2. So you can have, it cannot be all zero, okay? So an index, so the fact that this is non-zero means there has to be at least one place where a vector field has a zero, and there it has some well-defined index. So let's see how we can get this. So we could have one index 2, 0. Or we could have two index 1, zeros, for example. So let's look at what these look like. Typical example of a defect is something like this. A source, if you think of fluid flow. And the index is computed the following way. I should take another color. I take a curve. The defect is located here. Why is it a defect? Right here, the vector field vanishes. That's the zero. So if it's a wind velocity, it's zero. But if I step arbitrarily, an arbitrary amount in any direction, the vector field is non-zero, and I can get any value I want depending on the direction that I step. Okay? That's why it's a singularity. An arbitrary small deformation means I can get any velocity I want depending on the direction I go. So I go around this curve gamma, and I look at the vector field at each point, and I see how much it rotates as I go around the curve, and compare it to the sense of the curve. So, and I do that in units of 360 degrees. So this one rotates, what? Once, right? In the same sense as the field. So this is an index 1, or strength 1. Oh. Vector field defect. So what about this one? Now before you answer, let's take a vote on it. So take 1 minute. Let's take this one. Okay. Okay, so let's vote on it. What's the index of this one? Okay, minus 1. How many minus 1s? Okay, good. And how many plus 1s? Ah, it's about equally split. Let's compute it. So let's go around. By the way, it does not matter which way you go around the curve. I can go around this way here, and the field still rotates 360 degrees in the same sense as I go around. But let's look at this one. Which way do you want to go around? Okay, let's go around the same way. So here the vector field is here. I go up to here, it's rotated down this way. I go over to here, it's rotated over to here. I go over to here, it's up here. And I go over to here, it's here. So it's a plus 1, right? Okay, so this is tricky. Inverting n to minus n does not change the index of the field. So this is a sink for fluid flows. This is a source. They are both plus ones. They're the same kind of topological defect, even though you change the sign of the vector field, because it's an integral of n dot small piece of the curve going around. So you have to imagine a person standing here, stands in here, and then stands on his head, he or she stands on their head here, stands on their head here, and so on, and compare with the sense in which you go around. So how do you get a minus one? Yeah, so it's a saddle, or it's called a cross here in theory of vector fields. Goes by different names. You find an ice model of vertex models and so on. So it has two in and two out. Really, really different. Completely different symmetry and everything. So if I draw them up, it looks like this. Okay. Here's the zero. Near the zero, two fields are flowing in, two fields are flowing out. So you'll find these are in RG kind of flows too, fixed points like this. So if I do that, I go around the same way. I have the field goes out here, and then, you can see. And then when I get to here, it's going down. So it's gone this way. Person standing up here, standing down here, then goes, you know, like this, down, and then out here, and so on. So it's going around this way, right? Sorry, this is out. So this gives minus one. Everyone see that? Okay. And it has this kind of fourfold symmetry, whereas this had this nice radial symmetry. Okay, so this is a saddle or cross here and so on. Now actually, let me relate that to something else that you know. Yep. Let's do it. So let's make it go this way.
Right, I'm sure we'll have to do the same.
But yep.
Is it because the vector should go the other
way? No, because I have to follow it. So it goes out here, and then I have to follow it down this way. So then it's going this way. So I'm going this way clockwise, right, and I'm turning also from out up. Out, up. So rotating the same way as I go. It's dictated by the structure of the vector field. You see it, right? If I go this way, I have to go from out, I have to go down. Opposite sense, I'm going around this way, whereas the curve is going around. I'm going around this way, whereas the curve's going around this way, right? And if I do your sense, I'm going around like this, and the curve is going up, the opposite, the vector field. So that's why it's a minus one. Now let me relate two things that you know. Let's go on the sphere and triangulate it, okay? So we make some polyhedral structure like this on the thing. Triangulation of the sphere. So now I can put at every vertex, this is called a map on the sphere. So you can think of the regions as countries, the edges as borders, and the vertices as cities. So at every city or vertex, I'll have a source. Okay? So the field flows out at every vertex. At every face, I'll have a sink. And since it flows out here, it flows into the middle, flows out here. So it'll look like that, right? So this means, what do I have at the centers of these edges? Yeah, I have a cross here. So let me count. This total index only is the sum of the indices of everything inside. That's why it's a topological thing. It only depends on, it's like complex calculus. You look at everything inside the curve and add them up. You add up all the indices. So I can compute the total index here. Every vertex gives a plus one. That's what you just proved for us. Every edge gives a minus one. And every face gives a plus one. So the total index is V minus E plus F. And this is another topological invariant you've heard about. It's a way of computing the Euler characteristic of a surface. So for the two sphere, that is two. So that's consistent. It's not a proof of the Poincaré-Hopf theorem, but it relates those two topological invariants. Right? And you can easily compute for the two sphere, you can compute the Euler characteristic this way, because it doesn't depend on how you simplify your map. So you can eliminate vertices and simplify down. It holds for any map on the surface. So you can take this very simple one, like this. It has three vertices. It has three edges. And how many faces? Yeah, it has two. It has this one, and it has the back. So for that guy, chi is 3 minus 3 plus 2. So it's 2. So you've proved it for all. So you never have to remember what the Euler characteristic of the sphere is. You just have to draw this diagram, and you have it. Yes?
So microscopic interactions between the pneumatic particles, that doesn't depend. They don't know about the edges and vertices, right? Or do they?
No, they don't.
So why would you expect the topological defect to be at the vertices?
No, they're not. I was just relating this Poincaré-Hopf theorem to another theorem that you know.
Okay, so what you've drawn there isn't...
No, it's not. No, it's not that. It's not that. Good question. Okay, so now now we need to do something slightly different. We need to do a pneumatic field. So, for the pneumatic, we're winding around basically this RP1, S1 mod Z2, but it's basically like winding around the circle. So for every integer, we have a topological defect. But the basic structure of the defect is different. So for the pneumatic, in order to wind right around, we only have to go 180 degrees, right? Because we have an orientation. So this orientation is the same as this orientation. It's a line through the origin. So we have a different kind of, the simplest kind of defect for a pneumatic. The analog of this plus one, this source here, looks a little bit different. So it looks something like this, and you saw this plenty of times in the posters yesterday. The defect will be here, and I only have to wind 180 degrees to make some defect structure. So if I take it to be, say, uniform out here, I should start from here and rotate around. So I should go out here, and it should look like have gone not 45 degrees by the time I get up. By the time I go 90 degrees, it'll only have gone 45 degrees. By the time I go 180 degrees, it'll have gone 90 degrees. Right? It's a half angle. So it's going to look like this. This kind of structure. So because it winds half of 360 degrees, this is called a strength one half defect or an integer index one half defect. And then the minus one half, it looks something like this. You can do the same check and you'll see this rotates 180 degrees in the opposite sense. Now, nature exploits these kinds of defects. So take a look at your hands. See if you can find a plus one half and a minus one half on your fingerprints. Who says plus one half? Who says the minus one half? Because you guys are young, so the fingerprints are prominent. If you go to bricklayers and people like that, they're all worn off, the sandpaper. Ah, excellent question. Should you have both? So this was actually studied by Lionel Penrose. So he was a medical geneticist. This is Roger Penrose's father. Okay. So he proved the following thing. By the way, for fingerprints, this is called dermatoglyphics. So this one's called a loop. And this one, because of the threefold symmetry, is called a triradius. So Lionel Penrose proved that there are more triradii than loops, and the number of triradii minus the number of loops is your number of fingers minus one. So even though fingerprints are these characteristics that identify us, they all obey the same rule. Now, so how does that come about? So this must be the world's most difficult way of computing how many fingers you have. But it's great. So you have to have, you could have just triradii, but you can't just have loops. Somewhat counterintuitive. So it turns out that, so here's the hand. And sort of you have thumbs and fingers like this. Some of you guys can draw it better. The fingerprints on the edges look like this. Number of fingers is arbitrary. See, I can't. D fingers. We have dot, dot, dot in here. We're determining how many there are. And they go uniform across here. So let's say the total index, if you want to compute it, is just the number of loops. Loops contribute. I'm counting in terms of strength one half. So I'm counting the number of basic one half things. It's the number of loops, L, since they contribute plus one half. Minus the number of triradii. It's called N. T for triradii. We can compute it by any curve like this and count what you were asking. Number of triradii, number of loops inside. But we can also go all the way to the edge. So let's go all the way to the edge. Nothing is happening. Imagine you're a person, a student standing here, pointing out like that, head like this. You go around, nothing happens here, it's uniform. Nothing happens until you go under here. When you go under here, you have to go down. You're encircling the curve this way, and here you have to go down and around to get over to here. So at every gap here between the fingers, you have to do a minus one half. So this total index is also the number of gaps between the fingers. So if you have D fingers, this is D minus one. 1, 2, 3, 4 for most of us. So that's an invariant. Okay. And Roger Penrose, the general relativist, proved this topologically 14 years later in a paper that was a tribute to him. to his father. Okay, so now let's go back to our spherical pneumatics or spherical smectics. So we can have 1/2 defects, we can have plus 1 defects as well. Okay. So and if we take, for example, this kind of structure, which is a vortex for a vector field, which is a plus 1, that will typically break up for a pneumatic into two things like this, which look like two of these plus 1/2. So the total index being 2 here still applies, theorem still applies, but we have to make it up of objects that are either 1s or 1/2. So that means the solution is either 4 1/2, that adds up to 2, 2 1s, or 1 1 and 2 1/2. So this gives 4 total defects, this gives 2, this gives 3. Now, yes, you could have, okay, you could have 1 strength too. Yeah, so actually it depends on, so if they're pneumatics, 1/2 are preferred because the energy goes like the square of the index, but not for the smectics. For the smectics, a 1/2, 2 1/2 and a 1 are degenerate. It's a special feature of the smectic case where you have pure splay or pure bend. So here now, let's go back to determining what kind of faceted manifold that we have. So we need to specify a surface in three-dimensional space. Okay. So we need actually 4 points to specify a non-degenerate surface. So if we have 3, there could be this faceted structure could be degenerate in the plane. So actually, this is the preferred situation. So we need, if we assume that our ground state is going to have 4 pneumatic defects, then those can also be the places where we concentrate the Gaussian curvature. So the 2 defects come beautifully together and play a parallel role. So a defect will be where the pneumatic order vanishes for the reason, just like the vector fields here vanish, or the pneumatic order vanishes right at the core. Those places we can also concentrate the curvature defects. So this is what happens here. If you look, so I'll hand this around. If you look at these points here, then this is a 1/2 disclination. The pneumatic field goes around 180 degrees around each of these 4 vertices. Now, how many of these bases can we have? Okay. So how many coordinates do we need to specify a tetrahedron in space? 4 vertices, but how many coordinates is that? 12, right? Each is 3, point in three-dimensional space. So that leaves 12. We have translation symmetries and we have rotation symmetries, so that removes 6. We only care about shape. Everything is scale invariant, as I told you here. So we can scale out the overall size. So that gives 5 parameters. So an arbitrary, the space of possible tetrahedra is a 5-dimensional space. But not all of those are pneumatic or smectic ground states. This was constructed from flat space in a very special way. So if you look around these vertices, they have to fold up and to come together nicely. So that the sum of the angles, well, if you look down here, the sum of the angles around here, this one, has to be 180 degrees. So it doesn't have to be equilateral, but it has to be 180 at each vertex. There are 4 vertices, so there's a constraint. There are 4 vertices, but actually only 3 of the constraints are independent when you work this out. So that's 3 constraints. So that gives a 2-dimensional space of possible ground states for this spherical pneumatic in the zero bending rigidity limit. generally, they look like something like this. You can have you can fold up something that's not an equilateral triangle, and you have two arbitrary angles here, and the third one is determined by the sum of the angles being 180 degrees. So that's your two-dimensional space. Now, if I switch on an infinitesimal amount of bending rigidity, then I have bending across the edges. Liquid crystalline energy is zero, but the bending energy is the sum of the lengths of this tetrahedron. Minimizing the sum of the lengths gives you the equilateral triangle. So infinitesimal bending rigidity gives you the regular tetrahedron, the simplest polyhedral shell, the one with the least symmetry, by the way, as the absolute ground state of this system with any, without any calculation. So that's kind of nice. Now, then you have a two-dimensional space of ground states where the face is not an equilateral triangle, but an arbitrary scalene triangle. Right, so it's degenerate. It's two free parameters. For kappa infinitesimally different from zero, it's completely fixed, the regular tetrahedron. Now, what other shapes can you get? So if you change the order, so I said for vector order, the basic defect is a plus one. In order to get two on the sphere, you need one or two of them. For a nomadic, or this 2D symmetric, supposing I make them all out of elementary one halves, energetically that's usually the case, I would need four of them. And if I have p-fold order, some structure that has p-fold order, the basic, so it's invariant under rotations by 2 pi over p, the basic defect has strength 1 over p. So that means that I need 2p of them if I'm on the 2-sphere. So let's take p equals 3. So this is an object has symmetry like this, sort of like Mercedes-Benz symbol, like this. Basic defect is a 120 degree wedge that's removed instead of 180. So basic defect is 1/3. So I need how many of them? 6. So what do you think the preferred shape of that might be? Say somebody thinks at it. Yeah, an octahedron. So here's what it might look like. Here's the threefold symmetry at each face, and you fold this up, and you see at each vertex you've removed 120 degrees. You go right around and it comes back to itself with 120 degrees missing. So that's a 1/3 defect there. So if you can make something with threefold order, it should, in this floppy limit, so thin shell, threefold, triatic, should spontaneously fold into an octahedron. If you take p equals 1/4, so you take p equals 4, so that's a structure like this, it's a tetratic. The basic defect will be a 1/4 defect, so I'm missing 90 degree wedge. And you will need 8 of them. So that should give what? What? Cube. Yeah, that should give a cube. So this is what a tetratic would look like. Here's fourfold order. And it's obviously has, once again, you can build it from flat space. It has zero tetratic energy. And then you just fold it up. And it makes a nice cube. And at each vertex, you go 90 degrees, 90 degrees, 90 degrees. And you come back to yourself. Instead of having to go 360, you only have to go 270. So that's the 1/4 defect at each vertex of the cube. So in that second paper I gave you with Oksana Manuhina, we actually formulated the field theory of a tetratic system, just like the pneumatic, and determined the ground states, and it gives this regular cube. Yes?
So the vector order, the
yeah.
One or two.
Oh, okay. This was the total number, so I said you could have one index. Oh yeah, we didn't quite complete that. So for the vector field, what was the solution with one defect that some people realize? It's a dipole. Looks like this. So that object you can continue all the way around to the back of the sphere, and the only defect is here. So one index two defect for a vector field satisfies the requirement. So you can, so it can have, can exist with just one defective point. But normally you'll have two plus ones. Say looking more like this. Defect here and a defect here.
So if you have
yes, in this case.
Okay.
In this case, one.
Okay.
Why is this interesting? Actually, supposing you want to make objects that have distinguished points for attaching bonds. Okay. So this is called supramolecular chemistry. Suppose you want to build building blocks that are the analogs of atoms. And you want to have places where you make the analogs of quantum mechanical bonds. So you need distinguished points on the structure where you can glue things together. Defects are natural sites for that. In fact, not only you've seen that they're mathematically important and physically very important, turns out chemistry can recognize the singular environment of a defect as well. So in this endeavor, the number of defects that you have will determine the effective valence of this, call it superatom, whatever you want. And the relative geometry of one global geometry of one defect with respect to another will determine the kind of directional bonding that you can get. So you can go through all these examples. For the vector field, you will have an analog of either valence one or valence two object. So if you have valence one object, you can make, you know, analogs of diatomic molecules by connecting things at the defects like this. If you have valence two object, you can make polymer chains out of these objects by attaching ligands. The defects tend to repel and tend to be far apart. So you have to look at the statistical mechanics of the defects to determine the global arrangement of one defect with respect to another. And that will determine the directional bonding. For the pneumatic case where you have fours, was studied by David Nelson, this gives you a natural analog of sp3 bonding, say for a colloid. Okay. So you join them up at the ligands and you hope to make something like a diamond lattice or something like that. That's one of the things people have been trying to do for 25 years and haven't yet succeeded. So here, but just by varying the order of the basic object on the surface, you not only determine shapes in this floppy limit, but if you want to then use these as building blocks for molecules and then bulk materials, it also determines the valence of your basic building block. So you're not constrained by quantum mechanics. Can build lots of different objects. The valence is very specific, but it's determined by topology in this case and by the basic object that's ordering. And then you have to solve the problem of the global geometry, how the defects like to arrange themselves to determine what kind of directional bonding you can get. So for example, if you go back to the case of the symmetric on the two sphere, I told you that if you have the pneumatic on the two sphere, the defects repel like charges, so they tend to be far apart, so they really do sit at the vertices of an inscribed tetrahedron. Let's go back to the stiff limit where you have just a round sphere. You'll have 4 1/2 at the vertices of a tetrahedron. But if you go to the symmetric, to this pure splay limit, you have when you look at a structure like this. So a source and a sink at the top. So a plus one here and a plus one here. Then you can simply cut the structure along a line of longitude and slide it along itself. That doesn't change the structure at all, because it's a, I told you it was an integral curve. Sliding along itself keeps it coherently constant. All it does is separate this plus one into 2 1/2s. So some years ago we showed then that the ground state of the system has 4 1/2s on a single great circle, separated by an arbitrary angle, alpha. It's a zero mode of the system. So in that case, they're not the vertices of a tetrahedron, but on the single great circle. And if you functionalize them by attaching bonds, then the bonds would be all in the same plane going out like that. So that would change the kind of molecules you could make from it, and then kind of bulk materials you have. So you can design structures based on these ingredients. So remember the layers. The layers. So here I was drawing at the analog of a director field. So I think of this meant that the layers are orthogonal to that. So that's the constant layer space, and they're living on the surface. So no, it's fixed property of the structure, not changing from layer to layer. Okay. Right. Yes.
If you have a configuration where you have like vortex plus one at either end.
Okay. Yeah. So these instead, you mean like this? Yeah. So that would correspond to, so that's perfectly flying configuration. And if I that's a pure bend configuration. So that's just interchanging K1 and K3. So that's equally good. So I could have done K1 goes to infinity as well, and just taken pure bend. And that's another possible system. It has basically, but this whole thing has a symmetry. So you can take n alpha goes to epsilon alpha beta n beta. This is called a duality transformation, if you want to be fancy. And the free energy is invariant under that. It just interchanges the divergence and the curl. So bend and splay. So you always have this symmetry. Good question. More questions? Yes, Sid.
So you had your pattern.
Yeah. So actually it's you mean long compared to the edges, right?
Yeah,
actually I'll pass this around. It's actually very interesting. So it's mainly true, but you'll see that there are some edges where it's along the edges. So there are actually two edges where the director field is parallel to the edge, and four where it's orthogonal. So you need both.
But if you didn't have it parallel,
yeah.
But you can't do it so that it hits the next line over
the... With a jump.
With a jump, that's still continuous the way around.
So could I get to here and jump over, you mean?
Yeah.
So I think that's true for zero bending rigidity. For any finite bending rigidity, this edge will round out a little bit. And because the energy will actually diverge. If not, it'll go like at length over some radius of curvature of the edge. So once I round it out to continuously join, then I can't do the jumping. I believe. But zero bending energy, certainly, it doesn't really, I mean, I could think of this joining over to here. Yeah. Yeah. Well, canted where? It can't be canted along a face. Right. Oh, you mean twist like that, so it comes in at some angle? Yeah. Oh, yeah. 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 And drew them across some, yes. That's, yes, that will be fine. Yeah. Yeah, could do that. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, that's right. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. I think so, but they would have slightly different orientation, so yeah, might affect then how the defects. I'm not sure. Yeah, it's a good, it's a very good question. Yeah. Yeah. So okay. So I could make a cylinder also. It's not quite, okay, so that would give me something like a nanofiber. So that's possibility at zero bending rigidity is another structure, and then the spacing would just go around, you know, concentric rings around this. It's not quite two spheres, so I have to decide how to, what to do with these edges, but it's a reasonable structure. And then if I switch on the bending rigidity, I'll now have a bending energy which is proportional to the area, because it now has a bending around this way. Has a radius of curve, is a non-zero mean curvature, right? So this will give it, so a nanofiber is a possible ground state. It'll give an energy which grows as the area, whereas the tetrahedron gives an energy that grows as the length, so square root of the area. So for large area, the tetrahedron will win, but for small area, the nanofiber can win. So you expect these kinds of ground states as well. And the way people make these things is, we work with a polymer chemistry group at the Curie Institute, group of Minhui Li. So they take rod, they take coil, rod coil block copolymers. These make natural bilayer structures, they're called polymersomes. And then on this rod-like part, they put pneumatogens. So this is synthetic polymer chemistry. And then when the thing, if you're lucky, when it folds up into a 2D polymersome, the pneumatic order gets transferred to the 2D surface. So you get a 2D liquid crystal polymersome, thin shell. And those structures are seen to have these sharp faceted structures. That's what led us to study this problem. And they see nanofibers as well. Further questions? Okay, I think that's lunch.
So can you just describe the just relating to what was asked about the preference to go up a cylinder versus go around a cylinder in your director is really included in that spatial bit.